Welcome back. What I'd like to do is take you through four case studies which show you how to research internet censorship and how to create research questions, how to operationalize them, and how to make findings, and then also talk a little bit about the implications of your findings. So those are the four sort of takeaways I'd like you to have today. So what's an interesting question with respect to internet censorship research? How do you operationalize it? How do you make findings? And then how do you discuss the implication of your findings? At least I'll give you four examples of those. The first one concerns China. And the question that is often raised is, well, how good is a country at censoring the web or its web or its considered to be offensive of web? So how effective is internet censorship in a particular country? So the first project concerns the Falun Gong. Now, Falun Gong, as you know, is a banned religion in China, and also its content is actively censored. And the question is, well, okay, so how much of it is censored? Does some of it sort of slip through or not? So what we did in this particular project, in fact, it was a student project from this course, is first built a list of Falun Gong websites. And that list was made through a combination of using Wikipedia on the one hand and search engine work on the other hand. And I would imagine that this would be a popular combination for list building in your own work. Then secondly, we used the issue crawler. So we expanded the set of URLs. And we also created a means by which we could visualize our results. And I'll show you that in a second. We checked all of the expanded URLs through the Internet Censorship Explorer, and then we color-coded a map. So here is the issue crawler with a list of URLs that was created using Wikipedia as well as search engine work that was entered into the issue crawler. And out of the issue crawler, you get this visualization. And what you see is a visualization of websites or URLs interlinked. And then you only see the host names, but these are interlinked pages. And you see that they're color-coded. First of all, that you see that they're arrayed. It's a spring map. So there are central and there are peripheral nodes, and those nodes that are central are the ones that receive links from those other nodes that themselves are also central. And what you see is a color coding, which is according to top-level domain. So what we subsequently did is we took the list of URLs, which we extracted from the issue crawler, and we ran them through the Internet Censorship Explorer. You can run each URL individually, or you can run a list of URLs. I would suggest that you first run a few individually to see whether or not it's a particular proxy that's worth using, and then only then use input a list. And I would input not extremely long lists because it might take a while. I would input a few shorter lists. We got codes returned or timeouts returned, depending, and then we took our original issue crawler map, we put it into, loaded it in Adobe Illustrator, and then recolored the map. So what you see is a network of Falun Gong websites where nearly all of them are blocked. So you see at a glance the effectiveness of Chinese internet censorship. You see a sea of blocked websites. Now, through this technique, what we're doing here is we're showing a network of websites as opposed to a comprehensive list. So one of the things that you can talk about when you talk about the implications of this is you can talk about the extent to which this particular list or this particular network is, first of all of Falun Gong websites or not, number one, and number two, whether or not we're dealing with all languages. So in this particular project, it was largely Mandarin and English, not necessarily any of the other websites where Falun Gong publishes, for example, newspapers or has other online content. So you can ask yourself the extent to which Chinese internet censorship only deals with Mandarin and English, or also deals with other languages as well. And if dealing with other languages, do they, are they locating and censoring websites according to keywords in URLs, like Falun Gong is in the URL, or also on web pages, so keywords on web pages. So that's the third consideration. But in any case, you see that we've generally found that the censorship in China is very effective, at least for the Falun Gong. Okay. Here's the second project. Now, this project, the research question is, are we able to discover censored websites which were previously not known to be censored? Now, a lot of the work that goes on in internet censorship research relies on very short lists of URLs. And the Open Net Initiative, for example, when studying a country, will probably run anywhere between 200 to 1,000 URLs in a particular country, maybe a few more. But as has been boasted by the internet service unit in Saudi Arabia, this was some years ago, this was reported by the Reporters Without Borders, rsf.org, in their handbook for bloggers and cyber dissidents, and these sorts of projects go on and on. So you can find similar books or claims in contemporary literature. The claim here was that in Saudi Arabia, some years ago, that they were blocking something like 400,000 websites. But internet censorship researchers are only checking 1,000. So how do you expand the list? So how can you figure out? So this is where we initially developed the dynamic URL sampling technique. And so what we do is we took a list, an existing list, ran it through the issue crawler, fetched them through the Internet Censorship Explorer, and then again color-coded a map. This was the original list from a particular category. Put them in the issue crawler again, ran them through the Censorship Explorer. Now, what we did here in another step is we compared the list of URLs, the original list of URLs, with those newly discovered ones. So we figured out which ones were newly discovered. And then we color-coded a map. Now, this was published in Le Monde, the French newspaper. And you see, again, a sort of cluster map where the red ones are blocked URLs, the blue ones are still accessible URLs, and the red ones with little yellow pins on them were newly discovered. So previously unknown to the other internet censorship researchers that they were blocked. So this is newly discovered blocked websites. And this is a particular technique which lends itself to that, because you're taking lists of websites which are known to be blocked, and then you're running them through hyperlink analysis software to expand the list, and then you're checking them all again, and you're discovering which ones are blocked that weren't previously known to be blocked. I want to just point out really briefly here. One of the takeaways from this project, which is important for you to take note of, is that blocking could be on a page level as opposed to on a site level or a host level. So the researchers who were researching internet censorship in Iran at the time were researching the BBC, BBC News, but they were researching the host, bbc.co.uk. But when you run the host through the Censorship Explorer, you get it loads. You get a 200 OK response code, so it's not blocked. But if you run the Persian language BBC page or section through the Internet Explorer, you see that that's blocked. So they're blocking on a page level, and the issue crawler found that page as being the most relevant page on the BBC site, according to the other websites. So the other websites in this space, the Iranian websites, were linking to the Persian language BBC page as opposed to the host. And so the crawler found that, and the researchers were searching on a host level but not on a page level. So consider the difference between host and page level. The other takeaway is that the censors can use your work as well. So this was really the only map of its kind that we published. Because if you're a censor, you say, oh, look at those lovely blue websites that are accessible. Let's block those too, right? So one should clearly think about how one makes one's work available and whether or not one wants to make censors work easier for them. Okay, the third case study is of the United Arab Emirates, a country which has, in some sense, as we found out, quite some inequality, not only between the princes and the rest, but also between those living in Dubai and those not living in Dubai. So what we were actually interested in, or ultimately found, was the extent to which we could locate censorship of a particular demographic, or censorship of a spatial variety. So we were inspired initially by this quotation, the revolutionary gaze that Google Earth provides. And there was a headline some years ago in the Financial Times saying that finally the satellite view that one gets from Google Earth, or one could get as well from Google Maps, the satellite view showed people in Bahrain, in this particular case, in Bahrain, how large the land that was owned by the princes. So the extent of the land mass that was owned behind the palace walls that you could see from a bird's eye view. And this idea that now that this information was available, whether or not it would be well known by everyone in the country and therefore boost drives for more equality. So perhaps this information won't become known, perhaps it'll be censored, or where will it become known? So what we did is when we looked at a list of the proxies for the United Arab Emirates, what we saw was that there were two very, very different IP ranges, the numbers of the proxies. One started with 80 and another one started with 19 something. Well, they're here, in fact. When we ran websites through those two different proxies, one routinely had all the websites blocked, and the other one routinely, they were all accessible. And so we were like, well, what's going on here? Well, it turns out that that one of the there were two different providers, and one provider was basically providing internet access in Dubai, largely for expats and others, whereas the other IP address was providing internet access for the rest of the country, where everything was routinely blocked. So what you get here is spatial blocking, and this is something that Diebert and Rozinski talk about in their texts about second-generation internet filtering. So moving beyond the national view to a more regional view that can be either spatial and or temporal. So this was we found a digital divide, which is a finding that is of course an important one, which you can write up and discuss. Okay, here's the last one, and this is also written up in the reading that you have in the reader, an article that I wrote about internet censorship research. In particular, this case study is about, okay, content might be blocked in a particular country, but which content is that? And does the blocked content sort of move around the web and because it's on other websites become accessible in the country? So this considers the web as a kind of circulatory medium where content circulates as opposed to a medium of static websites where if you block a website then you've blocked the content. So it considers the web not as single websites or like books, but rather as a circulatory medium where the content moves around. So this is the assumption. The web is circulatory, not static, in the sense of single websites. But the question is, does that content which circulates, is that available in countries? Is that a sort of even a strategy? If you want to make blocked content available in other countries, is it a strategy to circulate that content onto other websites? So we did this for Pakistan, and in particular, we studied the case of Baluchistan or Balochistan, depending on how you pronounce it. Now, in Pakistan, the Balochis are a group of people who would like to become autonomous. They would like to no longer be affiliated with the central state, And they would like to have an autonomous region, their own state, or at least just autonomy. And they have a series of websites. Here they are in a list. And each of these websites are blocked in Pakistan. You cannot access them. Now, what happened when we were doing this research was their leader was killed, their tribal leader. And then two stories started to circulate about what happened. There was a Pakistani official story, and there was a Balochi or Baluchi story. And they were very, very different. One said that the Baluchi tribal leader was killed in battle, and the other one said he was murdered. He was murdered. Two very, very different accounts of why this leader was dead. So our research question was, okay, this is very interesting. Can you get the account of the fact that he was, get the Baluchi account, the story of his murder, can you read that account in Pakistan? Or do you only get the official Pakistani account that he was killed in battle? Yeah. So what we did was we went to each of the blocked websites that are blocked in Pakistan, and we pulled out key phrases. And we searched for these key phrases in Google, and we found other websites where these phrases were present. And we did the same for the Pakistan, their news authorities. We looked at their news authorities, pulled out key phrases, searched for them in Google, and found a series of websites where also those phrases. So we found the extent to which that content had circulated. And subsequently, we ran all of the websites where the circulated content, so the Pakistani circulated content and the Baluchi circulated content, ran those websites through Censorship Explorer for Pakistan. And we found out something extremely depressing, or it was an interesting finding, and that is that the Baluchi account was not accessible in Pakistan, even though it had circulated to other websites. Or it was accessible on two relatively obscure websites, which were extremely hard to find. So the idea of the web as a circulatory space, which because it circulates content, would circumvent censorship, was not the case. So again, we found out that censorship, in this case in Pakistan, was highly effective. So censorship, at least in this particular case study, appears to be working. So which is also what we found in China, but that was for a different kind of approach. This is more content-driven versus site-driven, as in the China case. Okay. To wrap up, I've talked quite a lot about how to build lists, and I also previously summarized these particular list-building techniques, so I won't do that again. But what I will do is talk very, very briefly, or summarize very, very briefly on these four case studies. So in each case, the research question concerned whether we could find out either how well censorship was being done, how effective, or it's the extent of it. How extensive is it? Yeah, so how effective is it? That was in the case of the China case as well as the Pakistan case. And then the extent of the internet censorship, that question was done for both Iran as well as the United Arab Emirates. So in the case of Iran, we wanted to know whether we could find websites that were blocked that people didn't know they were blocked, or internet censorship researchers didn't know were blocked. In the United Arab Emirates case, we wanted to see, or we found, that there was a digital divide, that the expats and the folks in Dubai had a free pathway to the internet, whereas everybody else in the United Arab Emirates did not. Had loads of sites being blocked, which weren't blocked in Dubai. So the two types of research questions are about effectiveness and extent or scope. Then in order to research those questions, one, of course, needs to build lists. When talking about effectiveness, one could rely on what I previously referred to as state sensitivities. So if you go to, for example, the Google Transparency Report or claims that are made by the Open Net Initiative about what is being blocked in particular countries, types of content, one then can build websites about that type of content and see how effective states are in blocking that content type. That's an operationalization. Thirdly, when making one's findings, one can talk about the extent to which a country has a blanket policy or a spatial policy or a temporal policy or some combination of them. So whether they're engaged in so-called second-generation censorship, that's an important consideration. So you could also think about when you're making findings, think about when you're doing the research. Are you researching a particular country during a period of unrest, during elections? Do I want to focus on a country that's currently having elections, in the run-up to elections, for example, and see whether I can identify blocked sites that normally aren't blocked so therefore are probably blocked because of the upcoming elections. And then finally, discussing the findings, the implications of the findings. So you saw that I talked about implications in a variety of ways. I mean, the first one was thinking about publishing your results or not, or making them public, so the extent to which they can be used by the censor or not, how to write them up so they can't, if you're going to publish them. One of the implications. Another one is, what are the implications for internet censorship circumvention? What are the implications for the content that's being blocked? One of the questions that we often ask in terms of implications of censorship is, does censorship kill content? If it's censored, does it then have no audience? So it has then no impact. So does censorship reduce the impact of the content? Or is censorship being circumvented and that content lives on and is being updated? So when content is being censored, does it remain fresh? And then finally, as an implication for much of this work, there's also other things that are more difficult to study, and that is the extent to which there is self-censorship online. So maybe people are not publishing particular kinds of content because they know it will be censored, or maybe people are slightly changing their content, making their content into code words or similar language, which won't be blocked but still get the message through. And finally, perhaps content isn't being censored because authorities would like to monitor the content, surveil its publication, and therefore go after the writers and the authors and the bloggers who are publishing this content. So these are more difficult implications to research as well as to discuss, but they should be something that you keep in mind. Okay, thanks very much, everyone. Enjoy your week.